Steve, where are we going today?
We're going to the Vanderhoosen River. It's a little tiny space, but I saw this image, as was alluded to earlier, and it's going to present quite a problem for the view camera, I can tell you that. So let's get started.
All right, let's go. One way to find out. Let's go.
I don't remember going that deep down that path. That's what happens. You start bullshitting with somebody and, you know, steps the mountain up. One of the problems I have is, you know, I want to have all the equipment that I own so that I'm not ever sad or disappointed that I don't have the best filter or the optimum lens with me. So consequently, that's one reason why I downsized to the 5x12 and incorporate a 5x7 back. It's now one camera.
Nice.
But still in all, there's a lot of other equipment that goes with it that sometimes it's a little heavy for this old timer.
Sometimes experience can outweigh the cost of carrying a heavy pack.
You know, there's plenty of people that would say, you know, I only go out with a couple of lenses, which is fine. That's fine if that's your, you know, philosophy and belief. Mine is, you know, what I see, I want to be able to put full frame. I don't want to have to, which is part of today's little exercise, that we could do a little bit of cropping and whatnot. But anyways, I gotta switch backs, and that other back is up here. This is one of the beauty of this camera. I don't know why other cameras can't incorporate this type of design. It's just so easy. You know, that's the back is getting changed right now. There's other camera manufacturers where you gotta change the bellows. It just seems bizarre that that's done. I just went from 5x12 to 5x7.
That was 30 seconds with talking?
Yeah.
We know how much you love to talk.
All right. There's this app that I have on my phone. It's the only technology I use. But it's a terrific little app. Naturally, it's free. But I can switch from a perspective of the 5x12 camera to the 5x7. And then over here, I hit the lens selection, and all the lenses that I have are listed here. So my sense is that this shot will be a 305, maybe a little wider. So I just hold that up like that. And that shows me the perfect 5x7 perspective with a 305 millimeter lens. The 305 is too long, so I go down to the next one, which is 210, and that's much more the vision that I see, is these angular trees, and they just seem to, the triangular, you know, relationships seem to go front to back all the way.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to start with a 210 millimeter lens and figure that that's about the perspective that I'm after. And it's thanks to that little app. We'll list the app in the video later on. All right, so I've got the shot composed on the ground glass, from obviously from side to side. You've heard me talk in the past about how I really pay a lot of attention to where the photograph begins and ends, in other words, the borders. So those are very important to me. Obviously, the center of interest is these angular, triangular set of trees that just seem to recede into the background. So then it becomes, where do I want to end, begin and end my photograph? So I've decided that, the composition is set. Now I have to get it focused. Now the interesting thing about this particular scene is, as you would have learned in the blog that I wrote about this particular scene, a friend of mine that I used to work with, talented artist but in and of his own right, he happened to come out here one day with his girlfriend taking a little bit of a walk, and he snapped a little cell phone shot of this. I saw these relationships and said, I gotta get here with a film camera. So my point is, with a cell phone, you can just walk right up to this scene, snap the picture, everything is in focus. So what I'm gonna demonstrate here today, at least from my experience with the view camera, which is pretty extensive, this is about the limits of what the view camera and my skill set can pull into focus. So you can see the camera is about 8 feet from that area, but yet you have that tree that's on the other side of the composition that's more like 12, 13 feet away. That presents a huge problem, being that close to the camera, when you still need to get essentially infinity in focus, which is the distant leaves and the distant trees. Those need to be in focus. That presents a huge problem with a lens of 210 millimeters. So for those that may not be familiar with a view camera or this size film, 210 millimeter lens is a normal lens on this camera. So think about it in the terms of 35 millimeter, 210 millimeter lens is quite a long focal length lens. Those two lenses share the identical depth of field by way of f-stops. So the only way that I'm gonna get something in focus that's maybe only 7 feet from me, actually less because I got pine needles in the composition, to essentially 100, 125 feet away, the only way I'm gonna do that is changing the camera movements, relationships of the front standard to the back standard. So in videos that I'm gonna link at the end of this video, I've really gone into a deep dive on view camera movements that Peter and I did in the darkroom, and you really should look at those, but this is an on-site illustration of the Scheimpflug principles and at least the movements that I'm able to use in the environment. So I talked about in those videos, if you define your composition as cube shaped, in other words, it has as much height and width as it does depth. Think of a square cube. The only friend you have for depth of focus is f-stops. There's no magical camera or anything that's going to do anything beyond that. The minute your composition, and you need to identify this early on, the minute your composition takes on the shape of a rectangle, then the movements of a view camera become your friend. And hopefully I'm going to explain those in an easy and succinct way for you folks to understand. So let's start out with this. You'll hear me say in the other videos, if you can do all your movements with the back standard instead of the front standard, you're helping yourself out because of the image, the circle of illumination that the lens throws. You begin using movements in the front standard and you use up a huge amount of that circle quickly. Whereas if you use the movements in the back, they do the exact same thing. You don't use up nearly as much of the image circle, which is very important. So as luck would have it, we are directly underneath a couple of branches that Peter has to hold out of the way. That's just the way it is. That's many times you're just not as Peter Bunick referred to, cooperative ease. Nevertheless, if you look at this camera right now, it is all zeroed out. In other words, the lens is in the center of the film. Both rear standard and front standard are parallel. It's just like a Hasselblad or a 35 millimeter camera right now. What I'm going to begin to do, if you can see this tree and that tree are significantly different relationships to the film plane. The other thing you need to realize is that tree over on my left, it is seen on the right side of the ground glass. In other words, the lens turns things, reverses them, and it turns them upside down, just as your eye does, and your brain turns it all around so that it looks normal. Hopefully everyone, every photographer understands that. So, if I take this back, and I remember now, the far tree is on the right, is on the right side of this camera. So if I take this back and I move it closer to that tree, that's the same thing as moving the left side, which sees the close tree. That's the same thing as moving that farther away from that tree. So I've now changed the relationship of those two trees to the film plane. I've biased it in the direction of being more the same relationship. It's not perfect. Naturally, that tree is still farther away, but it's not as far away. That's the big feature of the view camera. The other feature that I'm going to use in this is to get the far distance away, I can take this movement, take the camera back and do that. And what that does is that moves the closest part, which is right here. Remember now, everything is reversed. So the top of this ground glass, the top of the film, is seeing the ground. I've just taken that back and moved it farther away from the ground, which is the same thing as moving the bottom of the ground glass, the bottom of the film, which sees the distant part farther or closer. So those relationships have now become more manageable. So when you these are called compound movements. Now, most of the time in the environment, all you really need is this movement for a near and far relationship. But when you introduce things that are close in a composition, such as these two trees and also the bed of pine needles, you then can use this camera movement that I just spoke about changing those relationships. Now, it's interesting to note, and I've never heard this actually said, but when this ground glass is focused as I want it, almost none of the image is sharp. But the relationships are much more favorable, that where f-stops come into play and bring everything into focus. I'm not sure how I can explain that any differently than when I first set this camera up and I focused on the close trees. The far distance of the leaves and whatnot that are 100 or so feet away, they were so far out of focus, there was no f-stop in the world that would ever bring it in. And conversely, if I focus on that far distance and I try to rock the back to bring the bed in focus, these two trees are still so far apart that they're not in focus. So that camera movement of bringing this side of the camera closer to the far tree, that relationship pays huge dividends in altering the plane of focus for only what's in my composition. Getting back to the box and the cube and all, my composition is nowhere near a cube. It's a very long rectangle. Not as wide, but a very long rectangle this way. So I'm going to use this movement to help with that rectangle, but also this movement to help with this relationship of the two trees. Hopefully that is a clear understanding of what I've done with the camera movements. There's a couple other things that I want to just quickly to go into. In this composition, the running water is very important to me. I'm hoping that it doesn't go just all white. I want to have texture in that. So even though my optimum film is FP4, which is 100 ISO, the HP5, which I don't like as much, is a better choice because I get another stop and a half of speed, film speed. And you think about it, here's the trade-off. I may not like the HP5 as well, but I certainly don't like an out-of-focus image down here with the FP4 when I can't use, you know, when the f-stops don't line up with the running water. So it everything's a compromise with this type of photography. I can't just walk up here with a cell phone and snap the picture and, you know, get back to the car. It just doesn't work that way. That's part of the attraction to this type of photography for me, is the challenges, the puzzle to solve what's in front of me. So hopefully this video is informative and helps you folks. Naturally, you can reach out to me at powerofprocesstips.com. Email me at steve@steve-sherman.com. Comments, questions, anything of that nature, glad to help you folks out.